Well, welcome to the exciting world of financial economics. What we're going to look at is a range of financial institutions and financial markets. So to start with financial institutions, the main one that you've probably come across is that of a retail bank. So you've heard of retail banks such as Halifax, such as RBS and Barclays, Lloyds being another one. So these basically provide very useful services for households and firms. Okay. So, for example, your bank will provide a current account and a savings account. And this is a safe place where you can put your money. In the 19th century, people built banks that looked very secure and solid, and they gave the impression that your money would be safer, and they generally were, unless, of course, they went bankrupt. So current accounts means you can store your money there, and savings accounts often pay interest. Often you have immediate access saving, but sometimes you might have something like a 90-day account where they give you more interest because you can't get at your money immediately without a penalty. Banks also provide very useful things such as debit cards, credit cards, payments through check system or through standing orders. They also provide different forms of loans, overdraft facilities, so I can borrow up to £1,000 more every month, and that's an overdraft facility without any particular payment. They also, of course, provide mortgages. Now, you've heard of building societies, but building societies very much like banks, and many building societies have become banks with a full range of services. But building societies used to primarily take saving and lend to homeowners through mortgages. Now there's this other very different type of bank called investment banks, sometimes rather rudely referred to as casino banks, and we'll see one shortly. So you may have heard of Goldman Sachs, and certainly you've heard of Lehman Brothers, which collapsed spectacularly in 2008. Well, we'll look at just briefly why. Investment banks provide a range of high-end services. They're often based in the City of London or in Wall Street. Examples include providing services which facilitate and finance merger and acquisition activity. So if you have one large company, public limited company, wants to buy up another public limited company, then the bank will arrange for funding and provide advice. A big form of business. They also underwrite initial public offerings. That's when people make a share offering for the first time. So you have a medium-sized company, it's done well, and you want to expand further, then you can issue shares on something like the London stock market, and an investment bank will certainly help with that for a little fee. And then, of course, they trade themselves. Okay, although they try and keep an eye on the risks, they certainly trade themselves in foreign exchange markets, in commodities, in bonds, shares, and in futures markets. We'll come back to that shortly. And that's perhaps the reason for them being called a casino bank, and perhaps the reason for them being slightly dangerous. Because if we look at a bank like Lehman Brothers, they borrowed about 50 times the amount of liquid assets, the amount of cash-like assets that they had. And it was about like a pack of cards that eventually toppled over as a result of the subprime crisis in the United States. So some people argue, such as the Glass-Steagall Act in the late 30s after the Wall Street crash in 1929, that we should separate these two banks. They shouldn't be part of one bank. However, there are banks where they're joined together, and these are called universal banks, Barclays being an example of a universal bank, RBS being another example, World Bank has had a few problems. And people think that certainly you should ensure that the retail bank can survive alone, and that's the British compromise, basically. But some people argue, such as the legislation from the late 30s in the United States, that the two should be completely separate because it's safer for the ordinary members of the public and ordinary firms that use retail banks. And then we have insurance companies. So insurance companies, surprisingly, provide insurance. And we'll come to the insurance market shortly. You don't have savings companies such as pension funds, and basically people save regularly, build up their capital in a pension fund. The pension fund will invest in relatively safe investments that give a secure return, they hope, and you build up this and then you cash it in, you have what's called an annuity, and you can live off this when you retire. So pension fund, that's long-term capital. You also have unit trusts of a similar thing, but not primary for retirement, where people put regular savings into a unit trust, and then that's often invested by some amazing fund manager, perhaps, into a range of shares that they think are going to do very well in the future. And then we have hedge funds. Now, hedge funds are particularly risky. They basically are only available to high net worth individuals. Individuals that have over $1 million a year as cash, other than their primary residence. They're less regulated and they also tend to be highly leveraged. So they borrow more on top of the liquid assets, the cash that they have, and they often invest in quite risky markets such as derivative markets, which we'll come to shortly. So they make big gains, but they also make potentially big losses. And then finally, we have private equity funds. So whilst hedge funds tend to invest in the short term, private equity funds tend to be long term, against high net worth individuals I've just described already. But what they do is pool together their investment funds, and they tend to buy companies that are having problems. So if you've got a company that is struggling, might be on the stock market, its shares might be falling, it might be making losses, it might have potential. So a private equity fund will buy that company, might delist it so that they own it, and then they'll seek to reduce its costs, increase its efficiency. Generally they call that restructuring. That means job losses often. The trade unions tend not to like private equity funds for that reason. But the firms then make an increase in profit, and then the private equity fund will sell that company back and make, guess what, a good capital gain, if all turns out well. So this is the range of financial institutions. We now have a range of financial markets. A financial market is any marketplace where basically financial assets and services are bought and sold. Examples being equities, which you probably know as shares, bonds, currencies. So, of course, for most of us, saving and lending is very important. And the bank as a financial intermediary between savers and lenders is a very important facility. If we pretend we've got our friend here called Jane. Pretend Jane, okay, runs a successful firm producing chocolate. Now, I'll use her as an example. Jane might want to go on holiday somewhere beautiful, warm, like Mauritius. So she wants to save up, so she'll save regularly in her bank, gain the interest. She may want instead to lend to pay for that holiday. Okay. So she goes to her bank and lends money. Also, of course, when she goes on holiday, she might want a foreign currency. So again, a financial market will provide a foreign currency so that she can then have immediate purchasing power when she goes to foreign market. A bank will also provide cash, provides checks and debit cards and credit cards, which we've mentioned already. Okay. Now it may be that Jane runs this chocolate business and she wants to buy some raw materials, the cocoa powder, to make a lovely chocolate from, say in 6 months' time. Well, what futures markets provide is more certainty. We live in a very uncertain world, and especially in financial markets, especially currency markets, and especially commodity markets, prices move up and down in a volatile way. So to provide certainty for a small business such as Jane, what she can do is buy a certain amount of cocoa beans at a certain price in a certain currency, and this will be provided by a futures market. So they take on the uncertainty and the risk, and she can relax, looking forward to a holiday, knowing she can get the cocoa at a certain price. And therefore she can hedge herself through the futures market against adverse currency movements that might make her business unprofitable. And then of course, There's the possibility that Jane might have a personal injury. She might die, and she wants to leave money for her relatives. She might have an accident. She might have a loss. Someone might steal her chocolate. She might have a fire, and the chocolate factory catches fire. Or theft, of course, from some dodgy workers that like chocolate too much. What does she do? She can insure herself against this, basically by pooling the risk of that happening to her with other people. Of course, the insurance company will take a little profit from that, and of course, the insurance company will try to measure the risk of Jane being a particular insurance liability. Okay. So if she cycles fast down mountains, you know, with an inappropriate bike, then she might suffer from personal injury. So she might be a high insurance risk. Her premiums might be high. And yeah, this market is a vital market for many firms and individuals in terms of risk. And then, of course, one of the largest forms of insurance market is in London. London is bigger than the three next largest insurance markets put together. So it's pretty big. And then we've also got the market for equities, the market for shares. Now it might be the James Chocolate firm is doing well. People love Jane's chocolate, but she can't expand. She can't get enough money from a retail bank. What does she do? She goes to maybe an investment bank who gives her some advice and says, you can sell shares. And so she has a share offer in her company and goes public on the and becomes a public limited company, and maybe on the London Stock Exchange. That enables her to finance her expansion. And of course, share markets basically are mainly a market for second-hand shares, so people can buy and sell shares in companies, say through the London Stock Exchange, and that allows companies to gain funds for investment in order to expand. And so let us now look at different types of markets. So we've got the following sort of financial markets. Let's go around clockwise. Perhaps one of the most liquid is the money market. Now, liquidity just means immediate purchasing power. Cash, of course, is perfectly liquid because you could always buy something immediately with cash. A share will be really quite illiquid because you have to sell the share. You don't know how much you're going to get for it. Then convert it into cash, then you can buy something. Anyhow, there are big money markets. An example of transactions in money market would be the short-term borrowing and lending of treasury bills. Treasury bills are just very short-term IOUs that last up to 91 days. And that finances part of the government's national debt. You've also got interbank lending. So when one bank wants to borrow from another, they can borrow overnight for a few hours, or they can borrow for a longer period of time. Okay, let's give a little example. So say bank, this is sometimes called the overnight rate. So say bank A is caught short. It's a bit low on the liquid assets, the red bit. The liquid assets meaning cash or things like cash that provide immediate purchasing power. Whereas bank B happens to have had a good day that day. They've got lots of current account deposits. And so what happens, bank B is very happy to lend overnight or over a certain period of time to bank A, okay? And of course, for a certain degree of interest, okay? So therefore, bank A's assets then go up, okay? Higher, that goes down. And everyone's happy. And there are a number of interbank lending rates and agreements. Now, one of the most infamous is the LIBOR rate. And trillions of pounds worth of mortgages are actually linked to this rate. So it's a rather important rate. And it stands for the London Interbank Offered Rate. Something rather obscure until recently. And this basically provides loans, funds for 3 months. Some banks are willing to give, to lend for 3 months, others want to borrow for 3 months, and it's denominated in dollars. Only one little problem, Tom Hayes and a number of traders at Barclays, RBS and a few other banks basically thought they would manipulate this rate. So say you wanted to borrow on the LIBOR, then you would push the rate down and pay less interest and therefore a benefit financially. Say you were going to lend because you had a surfeit of cash, then basically you push the rate up. This rate was determined by a panel of banks, okay, and so it wasn't determined by demand and supply in the open market. But it was basically developed when bankers used to trust each other and say, my word is my bond, and they behaved in a gentlemanly way. Well, so it's kind of changed since Wall Street and since the 80s. So Tom Hayes actually ended up in prison for 14 years, his sentence was reduced to 11 years, other bankers went to prison. And that is the LIBOR scandal. And then that's the interbank market, and generally it works very well. And then you've got longer term capital, which is basically that of over a year. This is the capital markets, and these are basically markets for bonds and shares. For bonds, they're not tricky. All bonds are an IOU, maybe on a nice bit of paper such as this. This might be, I'll just give you a little example of bond. This might be a UK Treasury bond, redeemable, say, in 2037, 14th of December, important day, my birthday, don't forget it. And its face value is £1,000. That means, on the 14th of December, in 2037, you can get, from the Bank of England, £1,000. So, obviously you're going to pay more for it today, or less? Clearly you're going to pay less for it today. You say you might buy that for £500, and then in a few years' time you might sell it for £600. So you've made £100 over that time period. And you would buy and sell these bonds on the capital market. Bonds often have a fairly low interest. The interest rate is basically, in a simple bond, is the difference between what you pay for it and what you sell for it. And of course, it's redeemable for about £1,000 in 2037, on my birthday. So what would you pay for a bond depends on what you think is going to happen to interest rates in general and the rate of inflation, of course. Okay, so bond prices are quite a good predictor of that. And obviously you want to buy bonds you think are safe. And basically UK, USA bonds are considered to be highly safe, along with most Western governments. Those of certain poor countries might be a different matter, especially when you think there might be hyperinflation. And if bonds, the same with shares, is a big market, and mostly for second-hand shares. Sometimes these are called secondary markets rather than primary markets. And this brings us on to the amazing world of derivatives. Derivatives are potentially highly complicated and highly mathematical. But basically, derivatives are simply a security with a price dependent upon one or more underlying assets. Okay, I'll give you an example of a simple derivative. A simple derivative might be a futures contract, which is basically simply an agreement between two people for the sale of an asset at an agreed price. So like you agree to buy something off a friend in a month's time at an agreed price. That would be an example of a derivative, and this will be a futures market. An example might be, let's say Jane, for her cocoa supplies, wants to buy 100 kilograms of cocoa for £100 in 6 months' time. Right. And say John, who works at an investment bank, thinks, I think the price of cocoa is basically going to go down, so I'm happy to take that £100 for Jane, because I think it's going to be £90. Okay. But Jane thinks the price of cocoa is going to go up. So it's taking a bet on the future, basically. Hence the term casino banking for what a lot of investment banks do. Now, it turns out that if the price becomes £120, okay, then Jane can buy that for £100. But poor old John, at the investment bank loses £20. Okay, so the whole point of futures contracts, such as this, and that type of derivative market, is to transfer risk. So the person providing that service is taking on that risk and that uncertainty. Okay, and that's potentially useful within financial markets and potentially very lucrative and also a potential huge losses. There are many more complex derivative products, but we haven't got time to go into them. Obviously, we've got that insurance market. Insurance itself is very important, but also reinsurance is very important. So we can insure all sorts of things on the London insurance market, by Titanic, for example, not a great bet. Ronaldo's legs, a great footballer, insured for something like, I could be wrong about, it's 140 million. So what you want to do if you insured his legs is to reinsure them. So you insure, say company A insures the legs, but then part of that risk is shared out among a syndicate of say 10 or 20 or 30 other companies. They would then reinsure that with other companies, so the risk is spread across the market. And much of what goes on in world insurance markets is reinsurance. And then of course we've got our friends the foreign exchange market. The vast majority of foreign exchanges provide speculation so that people can speculate on foreign exchange movements. But also, of course, you need foreign exchange to go on holiday for imports and exports, hence tourism, and also for foreign direct investment. And then finally, we've got commodities markets. These tend to be very volatile, and there are a lot of futures markets in commodities. But basically, foodstuffs such as tea, cocoa, coffee is an important one, of course. Precious metals such as gold ore, diamonds, zinc ore, not to mention oil and gas as also key energy commodities. So there you are, this is the world of financial markets. Thank you for watching.